Hey out there, this is March 8th, 2018, and it's just about 9:25 in the morning here in Northern California, and I'll get into a lot of different stuff as usual. Always I get into economic stuff, and but I kind of wanted the theme to be, you know, getting it together and what it really takes, and you know, the fact that it takes a sober mind, it takes being very serious sometimes, because there is stuff that's very serious in life, as we all know. I mean, life and death, that's a very serious matter. You know, this idea that we are to be accountable someday for the beliefs, the philosophies, the credos that we embrace and those that we fail to embrace. And this whole idea of a deep reverence for God that many refer to as a fear of God, the fear of the Lord, the beginning of wisdom and all that, how important that is. And I believe that. I really do. I think that the only way that people will successfully get it together is by understanding that it is God that is allowing you to get it together, that it's His counsel through the Spirit of truth, through this Holy Spirit, whatever you want to call it, the Comforter, the Counselor, the Encourager, every good quality, characteristic, and attribute, all these invisible things that we value so highly that we wouldn't compromise or sell for anything, these beautiful virtues and values that we can all tap into. But this Spirit of truth tells us that in order to basically be every man's friend and to reach a state in your life where your ways please the Lord sufficiently, at least, so that He causes even your enemies to live at peace with you. I mean, the idea that I'm really not particularly paranoid, like I really don't think that I rub anybody the wrong way, and not because I wouldn't, it's not possible, it's just that I don't see any benefit. But I do excoriate, and I do sound condemning at times, I know. So, you know, it's all a paradox for me, just like it is for all of us. It's not easy. I mean, this business about loving your enemy that Jesus said, this is something we must learn to do. So as much as we all want to say, well, God's just stupid, that's just, you know, a typo or something. No, He meant it. And so this is how you can be every man's friend, even your enemy, whoever you perceive that to be. And of course, perception is reality, and this is something to remember, what people believe about stuff. We need to define terms. That's it. We need to have a meeting of the minds, because even though we're speaking the same language, we use words, we bandy terms about, but we don't ever seem to have a meeting of the minds. And I tell you, if I heard somebody out there in the limelight, you know, because I know that I have very small audience, that's fine, because I really just don't care. I mean, it can spread. That's what, you know, that's what it's all about, like leaven in the dough. So, you know, you talk to somebody, you educate them, you know, you kind of try to not let them prescribe to an ignorance is bliss philosophy anymore whenever you deal with people. And I get into that, but, you know, people got to tell it like it is. You know, preachers, these televangelists, and, you know, preachers in the churches, and guests on the Alex Jones show, and all these other high platforms that people are into watching, you know, the liberty-minded kind of stuff, basically. You know, embracing the best of conservatism, I like to think, and the best of liberalism. And, you know, understanding that we've been divided on purpose, that this is a plan, this is a scheme to bring down the country. Because as we know, you know, united we stand, divided we fall. And we've been falling my whole life. We've been falling. That's how these things work. It's not always just a spark ignites it, you know, a shot heard around the world. But it's a slow simmering death of a nation through division. And that's what they're trying to do. That's what they've been very successful at doing. We've all got to understand how these people operate and don't prescribe to an ignorance is bliss. And, you know, say, well, it makes my head hurt when I think about that. I mean, you know, you sound so cynical, but, you know, could it be true? And it is true. These people are diabolistic. Okay, they're devilish. and they're scheming. They're evil genius. So, you know, like Jesus said, we've all got to be as shrewd as serpents and as innocent as doves. We've got to get it. And we've got to help other people to get it. And don't let them hide. I mean, your enemy doesn't want you close to him. It's like King Solomon said, you know, loving your enemy is basically allegorically like pouring hot coals over his head, he said. This is what he had had observed. I think that people understand that, that really when you come down to genuine love, it's powerful. When you love even your enemy like Jesus did, even though he excoriated people, particularly like the money changers. It's a really abhorrent thing. We've got to understand what's really griping God and how we need to really rely on him to get us through this thing. But it's the money. This is the challenger. This is Satan's ambrosia, okay? Without money or any form thereof, this concentrated wealth, okay, which is just an idea by these evil geniuses. It's a scheme. It's a scam. Not to facilitate exchange like we're taught, if you're taught anything at all about money in school. I don't know if I remember being taught anything at all, but somewhere along the line, this whole idea of this method of facilitating exchange has come up, probably from reading The Wealth of Nations. I don't know. But you hear terms and you say, okay, is that the reason why was money invented? You know, is it better than bartering? I mean, what's the deal here? But no, it's not a means to facilitate exchange. It's a means to facilitate the theft of the wealth of the nation. That is the people. You know, I watch Alex Jones' show all the time, and he was taking a vacation with his kids, and he was talking about the great infrastructure and all this. And, you know, and he attributed it to capitalism. And these young people like him, I mean, I've got 15 years or more on Alex Jones, but, you know, so I can refer to him as a young guy, but they don't have the history, the firsthand empirical history of just observing this over the years, okay? Our country has been like Zimbabwe, okay? And Zimbabwe is a prototype, an archetype of this debasement, mass, you know, wanton currency debasement through cost of living inflation. Okay, and it happened very quickly, okay? But the good part about that is they got it out of the way, right? I mean, they figured out, well, we don't know any higher numbers. We're into the trillions now, and it'll only buy a roll of toilet paper. But America's been on that path my whole life, and that to me is not capitalism. I mean, we got to be honest and answer terms like progress. You know, forget your political affiliation. Is it working for everybody? If it ain't working for everybody, it ain't working. And don't play stupid and act like you don't understand all these people that have turned rabid communists and socialists out there. Don't play stupid, man. You know, the mainstream, the media, okay, and Alex Jones is mainstream internet media, okay? They need to educate people. They have a big responsibility. They are the cutting-edge educators. That's what an informer is. You inform the public accurately. So it's critical that guys like Jones and his reporters and his guests, you know, start parroting some of the stuff I'm talking about here. Just spell it out for people. Don't let them play stupid. Let's talk about capitalism. Let's talk about what supply and demand means and the accumulated wealth of the nations that is our inheritance, okay, by right, by God-given right. Not forget the Constitution. It goes beyond all that. Okay, God is the one that owns all the technology, all that infrastructure. God did it. Labor did it. Okay, like Adam Smith said, nothing gets done without labor. Okay, if the labor was rich from birth, they're still going to go out and work. That's what labor does. It likes to do stuff. It's like children playing. You can't stop people from doing it. And I would point to all the volunteerism out there. I would point to all the miserable people out there once they quit their jobs and retire. Okay. People need to work. They need to serve. They need to feel appreciated. They need to feel useful. It's a God-given instinct not to be decadent, lazy, self-serving slobs. Okay. It's what we do. We want to use our talents. We want to please people. That feels good. That feels affirmative. That feels affectionate. That feels loving. And that's what it's all about, is that You know, we got to get it together here. We got to understand the power of loving our enemy. I mean, your motive cannot be that, you know, you're going to love your enemy to pour hot coals over his head. Okay. No, you've got to reach out and you've got to love your enemy because it's the right thing to do. It's what God said we must do through Jesus. This is what he instructed us to do. Okay. We must love our enemies. We must learn how serious it is. We must understand what is written about, you know, these 99 righteous people that don't need salvation, that don't need forgiveness and mercy and all this. But that 1%, okay, if that's all it was, that does. Okay, God never forgets them. And that's got to be our attitude, is to say we're going to reach out to the bitter end. These people that would kill each other, I mean, it's horrible. I mean, all the stuff that goes on in this world is horrible. Okay, and it's all being manipulated. It's all being facilitated. It's all being induced by evil-minded people, evil genius. And it's all about the money, the control, the things that money buys them, that it gives them, that power. Okay, that, you know, that special little something that I'm in a special group of uber wealthy people. And it's very evil when they don't want you to be uber wealthy. You understand? Freedom is the term I would use for equality. A lot of people don't understand this term. Equality gets a bad rap because people say, oh, we'll never be equal. You know, you want to be equal and then you want diversity and all this. And diversity is not the opposite of equal. The opposite of equal is unequal. Okay, and once you open that box, Pandora's box, and you prescribe to a little inequality is okay, philosophy, you're evil. That's it. And there's your litmus test for whether you're going to hell or not. I mean, you are. That's it. So, I mean, this is serious business. What I'm trying to convey to people about, you know, be logical. Okay, but there's one thing that God isn't. He's not stupid. And we got to stop playing stupid. We got to be honest about things. We need to be free, absolutely free, okay, unconditionally free. From birth, that's it. Utterly free, that's it. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. No equivocation, no contingencies, nothing like that, okay? So this is what we need. We need to be real. We need to be serious about certain things. And this is one of those things we need to be certain about. And the only way I think I have even come close to succeeding at being a good, you know, child, son of God, friend, just friend of God, okay, is with his help, is with turning to him and saying, look, you know the difference. You know where I fall, where I'm being worldly and carnal and sinful and fleshly and all those things that don't account for anything. And you know that I struggle and you know I'm a sinner. And, you know, we confess our sin to God, okay, but we also have to, you know, be sure that, you know, we check in with him as far as whether we're evil or not, because we don't want to be evil. We don't want to be elitist. We don't want to prescribe to inequality in any degree, okay, because that's it. Because then you open the floodgates of hell for all the other people that believe in wanton inequality to come in, and you've got no standing. You've got no voice. Okay, you understand? You've got no clout anymore because you sold it because of your itty-bitty prescription, your belief in inequality. Okay, I'm talking about a dramatically, profoundly different paradigm from the one we all know from birth. The one where we've got this most onerous tax of all that we euphemistically refer to as a cost of living tax. Okay, just we don't even call it a tax, but indeed it is. Okay, we gotta help people understand capitalism, and what it means, you know, to believe in supply and demand, and free market, and the direction that we are to go. What is progress? In other words, we've got to be really honest and define progress here, because I'm not saying that, you know, it needs to be this big dramatic shakeup where all of a sudden there's no more money and we don't know what to do. I mean, you know, it's like, this is insanity. No other creature in the world has any use for the stuff. Would rather have a bite of its favorite food than $1 million. But every single one of us without fail, including myself, and God knows it. See, invite God into your sinful nature. always invite God in to set you straight, okay? But every one of us would take the $1 million over a bite of our favorite food. Duh, right? Okay, because that's the way we're programmed. That's the way we've been trained to believe that we absolutely cannot function. We cannot live without money. That there's just no way. How could that be possible? We can't wrap our minds around it. We can't see outside the box. And I feel like the only guy in the world sometimes that puts the glasses on. And God allows all of us to. It's just tapping it. Well, God, how would you have it if you were running this show? Well, since I'm not an elitist, you know, and I'd become an atheist in a moment, in a New York minute, as they say. Okay, if I believe that God was even slightly, a little bit elitist, okay, I would have nothing to do with a God like that. So I know that the nature he's trying to...